As mentioned earlier, for the sake of simplicity, we'll just deal with integers when talking about fixed point numbers. We've already looked at addition in the previous section, and it's simple, right? We just take two binary numbers and do a bitwise addition. If two bits are 1, we carry the excess over to the next bit position. Simple. Fixed point subtraction is the same as addition. There's no difference in the operation. If you're subtracting 7 from 10, for example, we first convert 7 into its 2's complement form. That's the same as taking the negative of the number. Once we do that, the bitwise operation is the same as addition. Multiplication of fixed point numbers is essentially the long form multiplication method that we've been taught at school for decimal numbers. For instance, take two numbers, 10 and 5. This is their binary equivalent. Perform a multiplication step for each digit of the multiplier and sum up all the properly shifted results. The bitwise multiplication step itself is a logical AND operation. The result is 1 only when both the multiplier and the multiplicand are 1, and it's 0 the rest of the time. There are a few observations that we can make here. The number of add operations required to multiply two n-bit numbers is n. And then there's the logical AND operation required to generate the partial sums in the first place. The individual operations may be trivial, but the time complexity for multiplication operations to finish is big O n squared. Obviously, modern processors are optimized to multiply fast. For example, modern processors can multiply two 64-bit numbers with 6 additions rather than 64, and can do several of these steps in parallel. Another important note here is that the product requires more number of bits to be represented when compared to either the multiplier or the multiplicand. Look at our example here. We have 10, which is a 4-bit number, and 5, which is technically a 3-bit number. The resultant product of two numbers, which is 50, is a 6-bit number. In general, we can say that a multiplication between an m-bit number and an n-bit number results in a number which has at most m plus n bits. Now, this is a problem with fixed point numbers. Overflow is always a possibility when multiplying two fixed point numbers, when representing the product within the same sized container as the multiplier. For fractional numbers, there could be a loss of accuracy, and for integer numbers, there could be a loss of a significant digit. Dealing with overflow during multiplication is also very expensive. A common way to avoid overflow in intermediary steps of multiplication operations is to have an extended width register when summing the partial products. If the width of the register, computing the partial sums of a multiplication between two 32-bit numbers, is 64 bits, overflow would never happen within these intermediary steps. This avoids potential loss of precision at every step. Of course, in the end, the value from the extended width register has to be pushed into the normal sized registers. And this is where overflow would essentially happen. And there's no avoiding that. Alright, so multiplication involves a fair few steps. But there are certain values of multiplier for which the multiplication operation can be highly optimized. This is when the multiplier is a power of 2. We'll see why that's the case when we explore a couple of new operators. The binary bit shift left and the binary bit shift right operators. The idea behind them is simple. Take the bit shift left operator. It's essentially shifting all of the bits by one position to the left. When you do that, the position index 0 is no longer occupied by any bit, so it's initialized to 0. And the last position index on the left is pushed out of the container, and so an overflow happens. And any value that bit previously had is now discarded. Alright, but how does that actually change the value of the binary number? Take a simple example of the decimal number 50 in binary. If you perform a shift left operation once, you end up with this state. The decimal equivalent of this number is 100. Let's perform the shift again and we get this number. This is the decimal equivalent of 200. So what's happening here? Every time you bit shift left by 1, we end up with the value times 2. If you bit shift twice, you end up with the value times 4. More simply, it's a power of 2 operation. Bit shift left 5 times, and you end up with the value times 2 to the power of 5. As you can imagine, the bit shift right operation behaves pretty much the exact opposite. If you shift the bits to the right, the bit that replaces the most significant bit on the left is initialized to 0, and the bit that was present at the LSB on the right is shifted off and discarded. An overflow would never happen with bit shift right operations, but it could result in loss of accuracy. Take the same example as before, the number 50. Bit shifting right once will result in this state, which is the decimal equivalent of 25. So it's essentially a division by 2 operation. Do it again, and the state is this. Logically, the value should have been 12.5, since you're dividing 25 by 2, but as you can see, the LSB which contained 1 in the previous step is discarded, which essentially resulted in loss of accuracy. Because of this, the resultant number is a decimal equivalent of 12. So clearly, the operation resulted in an imprecise number. This is one of the big problems with fixed-point arithmetic, especially with the division operation, where the result cannot be represented accurately within the fixed number of bits that the number format can represent. We either have to truncate the result, where the fractional part is completely discarded and only the integer is retained, or the result can be rounded, where an additional check is required to round the number to the nearest integer value. Since the range is linear, the loss of precision is much greater on smaller numbers when division and multiplication operations are involved. We'll discuss this later when we talk about the problems of fixed point. So, clearly, bit shifting is the way to go when we want to multiply and divide numbers by powers of 2, right? So should we rethink our approach and handle different numbers differently when writing code and go back and refactor all of our existing code? No. Compiled languages like C++ go through an intense list of possible optimizations, and it will do this for you. Let's check this out in action. We'll go to a webpage called godbolt.org, which is a popular compiler explorer, a tool for determining the assembly instructions a compiler would output. Every compiler is built differently, they all have their own optimizations built in, and for the purposes of this demo, I'm going to select the Clang compiler, and I'm going to write some code. I'm just going to declare an unsigned integer, assign it to 10, and multiply it by 32. These are the assembly instructions generated by the compiler. And the assembly instructions are essentially the lowest level of programmable instructions to a computer. An assembler would then convert these instructions into machine code or bytecode, and this would just be pure binary data. Anyway, in the list of operations is this, SHL, or shift left, and it's for 5 times. We didn't explicitly write a left shift operator here. The compiler optimization handled it for us. Divided by 4, let's say, we get the right shift operation this time. If you multiply any other non-power of 2 number, like 15 for example, the compiler resorts to the unoptimized multiplication operation. Because of the binary number system and how numbers are organized in storage units, there's quite often an advantage of using power of 2 numbers, especially in multidimensional arrays. There's also an advantage of using them in the size of audio buffers, and for reasons slightly different, in FFT buffers where the fast Fourier transform algorithms generally always prefer a power of 2 sized buffer for computational efficiency. But there can be unintended consequences while using power of two size data structures. A cache miss could cause significant performance hits to a running application if the data structure cannot be fully held within a CPU cache, which is also a power of two structure. If the caching cannot be done, the program would have to fetch data from a higher level cache or from memory, which can be slow. It's beyond the scope of this video, but I've linked a couple of articles which talk about cache misses. As a general guideline, if you're an application developer, don't worry about optimizing code. Worry instead about writing clean and maintainable code. Only ever think about optimizing when you notice a need for one. And never assume that a preferred optimization strategy would work for your code. Compilers and the hardware underneath have subtle ways of not working the way you want them to. Always test and profile your code to find out how long it takes and to see if you've gotten any performance advantages from one method over the other.